say, with me, just I saw internationalism as anti-nationalism. Now, that's true. I most certainly did and do. I mean, it. One of our very basic documents, the thesis of the Comintern and Second Congress, 1920, on the national and colonial questions, it postulates as an essential part of what we were to do. Backing nationalists, revolutionary nationalists, who fought, but it also postulated, to lay down, that the communists would oppose the chauvinism of the oppressed people, even the oppressed people. I mean, that's in that sense, I'm anti-nationalist. But I mean, I'm not, I have, tell me the facts, in what way have I not been in favour of Ireland's independence and freedom and so on?
No, I think you did. I think it's not so maybe what you intended to do, but it had that effect on a number of people in the LWR. The way you postulate.
Who did it influence?
What?
Who in the LWR was influenced by that?
Well, they all were. I mean, you know, it was at that time, at that crucial point in time, and then gradually they got national. And then, of course, they went overboard and joined up with Pierre Lambert, and they were sort of became increasingly, decreasingly irrelevant almost. You know, they staggered on as we would do later on. But it was, that was the... There was this almost fear, and I would have maintained that I agree with you. You're absolutely right about the danger of the chauvinism, but that assume that any sort of national democratic demand is automatically wrong. That was LWR at that in the early 70s.
They wound up as bloody nationalists.
Exactly, they did. Yeah, they did. They did the U-turn.
The Lambertists.
Yeah, no. Well, they moved. Yeah, they moved to land. They moved. Started off like that, and then they. You know, it was a rather difficult position to maintain. So they went. Did the 180 degrees turn? I mean, I agree with you. But they
when did they have what you call the anti-national position?
Well, it was there in 1969. You know, it was all, and that was one of the reasons why we were able to form the Irish section. That people could see that it was bad, that the line was bankrupt.
But they were at that stage part of the Lambertist International.
No, they weren't at that stage.
They joined in 1970. 72. I remember it very well.
Well, they had this, they were certainly discussing it. Anyway, this was before 1972, definitely, you know, at the time when there were greater possibilities before the provos had really got up.
Yeah, but the fundamental thing, do you remember the 1917 debate we had at Trinity College? On the Gerry-Healyites. Had become a big power inside the LWR, and we had a debate with them, and then there was a split. Dermot Whelan?
Yeah, I know that, and I know there was a debate, but remember, I wouldn't have been there.
You were there.
Was I there? Well, I forgot about it because, you know, I was tricked. I would have been on the side. I wasn't a Gerry-Healyite or a Paddy Healyite at that time, so there I was.
You became effectively. A supporter of Guevarism. The early Mandel group was, in fact...
I know, there was that sort of a romantic tendency which...
You idealised Saor Éire.
What?
You idealised Saor Éire. You had excessive hopes that never made any sense.
Well, I had hopes of it. I will admit
I'm
that I had
group,
hopes
not
of...
Not just you.
I had hopes that Saor Éire might... develop in the proper way. It didn't make sense. And once Peter Graham was dead, I think that was really what, you know, any possibility there was killed with him. I mean, I think there were people there who could have been, who might have been saved. I don't know. We're looking back. I don't know. But it seemed at the time they were, they did know sort of a bit more. Some of them did know a bit more than sort of just hand over the cash.
Well, Johnny Morrissey, he knew more, but he had evolved from the IWG to being effectively just so.
Now, Johnny, I'm not sure about Johnny, but because Johnny, when he joined SE, was a classic case of a demoralised Leninist.
Maybe.
I mean, classic, you know, it was really, he just, I mean, I kept trying to talk to him, look, you know, it's not over yet, Johnny, you know, we can still do things. And he just completely gave up. I think he, you know, in there was this referendum in the autumn of 68. You will remember the PR referendum, and you know, we all had to, you know, we all went out and defended bourgeois democracy against sort of the single transfer, against the first past the post thing. And
Johnny did.
Johnny just sat around. You know, I don't know if he did, if it, in fact, he just sat around, or if he was joining Saor Éire at the time. But he certainly didn't come out and campaign and knock on doors or do any of the sort of elementary things.
But in the split period, Johnny was said by others, I never heard him say it or write it, but he was said to believe that the Irish Revolution, quote unquote, would be 90% national. National issues.
He never said it to me.
Right, he never said it to me either, but that's what I remember.
Well, I mean, you know, I mean, I was closer to him and he never said it to me. And possibly he said it, you know, I mean, it was the fact that it was all his fellow Tipperary men who went over to you that probably was as much as anything what caused his demoralisation. And I mean, demoralisation. What?
Johnny was specially close to Lawless. Johnny Morrissey was especially close to Lawless.
He was especially close to Lawless, and he was also, but he also, they were all, you know, he had, I think, I'm not sure whether, but he was, associated, because of geography, with people, with Paddy, with Christy Hussey, with the two Boyles, you know, they were all from his neck of the woods.
Yeah.
He felt that he was a mentor who'd been deserted by his followers.
Right.
And that sort of thing. I don't know if you, that sort of thing, I would say, was probably pretty demoralised. Would have contributed to his demoralisation. I think as Lawless said, one of the more perceptive things was, you know, I hardened, Johnny softened during the debate, during the polemics, and I hardened to a great extent.
Yeah.
You know, that's...
I mean, we used to think of you as Gerry puts it, our centrist.
Oh, yeah, well, possibly you dealt that, but I was in the centre at that time. I was right up until the Moran Sattel meeting, I was hoping that and trying to keep people together, even if I was critical of you.
So our side did not want to split.
Well, I didn't want to split.
For example, when you and Paul Gillespie, I think, tried to join the LWR, I mean, I fought to get you in. Mm-hmm. Maybe I didn't do it strong enough, but I mean, the idea of the split, I did not want to split. The idea that I deliberately, well, that I wanted to split even, did not.
Okay,
it's point I need to make, and it's the homogeneous party. Now, I used the jargon of the Canaanites, and I think I wrote that. But I mean, I also wrote a constitution that was passed unanimously, which allowed for the coexistence of people of different factions. Mm-hmm. You know, and one of the things I was trying to do was get the various political elements in the IWG that were miles apart to relate to each other, to discuss. Mm-hmm. But I certainly did not, in any sense, or any degree, believe in chopping them off. Homogeneous, maybe an unfortunate way of putting it. It was the jargon. But, I mean, the Constitution tells you exactly what I wanted to do. And I did not want a split, or to drive people out, or to make it a monotone organisation.
I believe you. I mean,
our group's never been. Beside the point. Go on.
I'm just going to say on this matter, you know, I certainly believe that you did that. If I'm going to look into things, there may be papers in the Labour History Society Museum, but I'm telling you something. You probably have more papers of that period than I do. Because when the internment was introduced in the North, there was generally a scare that it was going to be introduced in the South. So I spent a whole day burning our documents.
Oh dear. But now look, in the South, Lynch apparently decided to bring it in against Saor Éire, and then he was forced out of it. Mm-hmm. But they actually came very close to it. If they had brought it in the South at the same time, it might very well have led to a different outcome in the North.
It could have been, but in any case, the point was I wasn't going to let those papers get into the wrong hands. So it was a bloody difficult task. You know, we only had this. I had this gas stove, and having to put papers onto. You know, it was one of the sort of. Quite difficult, but a lot of valuable material went up in smoke, and nobody ever regrets it more than I do. But I don't know what you do in these. Yeah. Possibly go out to the Dublin Mountains and bury them, apart from the X, or